collection of materials from the Karaite communities in Cairo. The initial arrival of the materials to Berkeley dates back to the early 1970s, 1974. And it's been long coming in terms of studying the materials. There was an initial interest in the 1980s, so the materials were transferred to Jerusalem, to the National Library, and they were microfilmed there, and then eventually returned to Berkeley. They've been studied by scholars who were at UC Berkeley and who went through them at different times, and this is a new round of scholarship that we are witnessing today. So when we look at this in perspective, we see generations of scholars that have been engaged in these materials, and we are also working towards what we hope will be a very engaging exhibition here at the Magnes in 2018. The talk today, and I'm just going to say a few words about the fabulous speaker in a second and his amazing entourage that I see coming in today. The talk today is part of a series that we have every week. We match a presenter with materials. Sometimes the matching is sort of that type of matchmaking that you sort of engineer without knowing exactly what the results will be, and it's about finding sparks of interest and connection. In this case, Alan Elbaum, who is next to me and who's about to speak, has been working. Oh yes, we also engage in the very ancient Karaite tradition of turning off our cell phones during a talk. So remember that. Alan has been studying manuscripts at the Magnes for now over a year, I think. And so he's part of our team. We engage graduate students, and as many of you would know by the bio that was shared online to announce this this talk, he's one of these wunderkinder. He's both in medical school and working towards a degree in the history of medicine here at UC Berkeley, so UCSF and UC Berkeley. And he's working, as you can see, on medical texts that often overlap, as we know from a variety of materials we have in the collection, not just the Karaite one, overlap with the broad concept of magic. So it's a pleasure to have Alan here today. There is a small selection of manuscripts. You're welcome at the end of the talk to come and take a closer look. It will be here after the talk, and so we'll be Alan with to answer your questions at the end of the talk. So thank you so much for joining us. Welcome all of you, and let's enjoy the talk.
Thank you so much to Francesco for the extremely flattering introduction, and thank you everybody for being here. It's great to have so many people who are curious about magic and medicine in the Karaite manuscripts at the Magnes. So I'm going to start right off with two examples of these magical medical fragments before backtracking to tell you about what this collection is and what I'm working on here. For someone who drank a deadly poison, write these names on parchment, and the one who drank the poison must swallow them. It is confirmed. Paron, Paron, Han, Pinar. Caron, Han, Paron, Pinar. Han, Paron, Caron, Pinar. Haneni, Zira. If there is enough time to write them in a state of ritual purity, all the better. If not, it's sufficient to write them in a state of holiness, and it is confirmed. Now, a second one. If somebody is ill, or if somebody's missing, or if somebody has run away, add up the numerical value of their name, their mother's name, the day of the week, and the day of the month, add an extra 20, and divide by 30. If your remainder falls on the table of life on the right, then he will live. And if it falls on the table of death, then he will die. Okay. Most of you know me already, but I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself and how I came to this material. I'm a medical student at the UC Berkeley-UCSF Joint Medical Program, which is probably the only place in the world where this kind of research can be folded into a medical curriculum. The first 2.5 years of the program are here at Berkeley, where we write a master's thesis on anything at all that relates to medicine before moving to UCSF to complete our clinical rotations. My own master's research is on the experience of illness based on fragments from an archive called the Cairo Genizah. These were fragments from the Jews of Old Cairo from about 1,000 years ago. The manuscripts that you see on the screen and in front of the room are also from the Jews of Cairo, and they're also about illness and medicine, in a sense, but there are a couple of major differences. One is that the manuscripts here at the Magnes are considerably more recent. The latest one that I've seen is from the late 1700s, and what makes the Magnes manuscripts really unique is that they belong to a particular group of Jews known as the Karaites. So who are the Karaites? The basic definition is that Karaite Judaism is Judaism based on the plain meaning of the Torah. Non-Karaite Jews, like myself, are known as rabbinic Jews or rabbinites. In addition to the written Torah, we believe in the authority of the rabbis and the oral Torah that was eventually codified as the Talmud. The Karaite minority for the last 1,200 years has developed an extremely different form of Judaism, although they've always lived side by side with rabbinic co-religionists. The map up on the screen depicts the birth and early development of Karaite Judaism, where it started in Persia and Mesopotamia in the early Islamic era, and spread from there to Jerusalem, Cairo, North Africa, and Asia Minor. These first centuries were a golden age of Karaite scholarship and literary production. We owe to them much of the theory of Hebrew grammar, as well as the authoritative text of the Hebrew Bible. Now, fast forwarding 1,000 years to the middle of the 20th century, when one of the major centers of world Karaism was in Cairo. Over a period of some 30 years, approximately 1948 to 1973, the Karaites, together with almost all the other Jews of Egypt, were either driven out or they left voluntarily rather than waiting to be driven out. There are about 30,000 Karaites in Israel today and about 1,500 in the US, where the largest community is right here in the Bay Area, and I recognize many familiar faces from that community in the audience here. My interest in this project began just over a year ago, at around the same time that I started attending Shabbat services at the Karaite Synagogue in Daly City, where I was welcomed with incredible warmth and hospitality. Those of you who know me in the audience have probably heard me talk about the Karaites, and how I felt most at home there out of any Jewish community in the Bay Area. The manuscripts and artifacts here in the Magnes have had a similar trajectory as the Karaites themselves, from Cairo to the Bay Area. It was Seymour Fromer, the founding director of the Magnes Museum, who visited the remaining Karaites of Cairo in the early 1970s and acquired several dozens of artifacts and manuscripts that had belonged to their community and that were stored in the synagogue pictured here, the Moshe Darby Synagogue. I'm currently researching this collection and working towards curating an exhibit, which will open in either January or August of next year, and which will take a much wider view than just magic or medicine. This pop-up talk is my opportunity to share some of what I've discovered along the way. Jumping ahead. Before diving into magic and medicine, I want to make a few caveats. The first is that this is only a tiny fraction of the manuscripts that we have here related to the Karaites. There are also holy books and literary texts. There are books of weekly parsha sermons. There are court decrees, there are marriage contracts, and many more. Another thing is that there probably, you can't say that there's anything uniquely magical or occult about the Karaites, and the magic I'm showing you is not uniquely Karaite. If we had the archives of the rabbinic community in Cairo, we'd be looking at probably very similar texts. The final caveat is that the authors of these spells wouldn't have regarded them as black magic or the kind of witchcraft that's prohibited by the Bible. On the contrary, many of the spells are based on the divine names of God. Others stipulate that they only work if they're carried out in a state of ritual purity, and others require that you do them with a proper fear of heaven in mind. Since we'll be talking about magic for the next half hour, let's take a moment to define it. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, it's the use of ritual activities and observances which are intended to influence the course of events or to manipulate the natural world, usually involving the use of an occult or secret body of knowledge. If you've come here today with a clear sense of what is magic and what isn't, then one goal I have is for you to leave more confused than when you came in. So let's take this definition. It's not at all clear why modern medicine shouldn't fall under it. If a patient comes to me with asthma, I'll carry out a series of ritual motions to listen to their lungs and their heart. I'll prescribe some medications that are intended to influence the natural course of their disease. And the knowledge I'll use to do so is certainly secret. Lay people don't have access to this website, for one. And apart from that, I'm paying tuition for so many years of training precisely to acquire this secret set of knowledge. So, in line with leaving our preconceptions about magic at the door, I'm not coming to this talk with a prior framework or a thesis about the relationship between magic and religion and science and medicine. You can fill up many bookshelves with academic books on the question that I haven't read. Many excellent books, I'm sure. But really, I am an enthusiastic amateur who has spent a lot of time immersed in these documents and want to share them with you. Here's a picture I took in Cairo last summer to give you a sense of the physical objects that were essential elements of these magical spells. But for the most part for the talk, and based on the materials here at the Magnes, I won't be talking about historical or physical evidence for what spells were actually used day to day or how people interacted with them. I'll be talking about magic as a literary and theoretical genre. The books can tell us how the authors and their audiences thought about magic, but not necessarily how they used it. That said, there are times when real life does shine through. The antidote I showed you at the very beginning contained the phrase, "it is confirmed." The Hebrew is baduk, or menuseh, and it means, "I tried this, and it worked." Some of you say, "it is confirmed many times," which I take to mean, "I tried this ointment on my hemorrhoids several times, and it works every time." None of these labels, confirmed, ever appears on the spells for teleportation. There are two main sources that I'll be drawing on for this talk. There is one, and both examples are represented in the case up front. The first is a Hebrew and Italian book where the antidote came from, and the other is a collection of miscellaneous loose leaf fragments in Judeo-Arabic, which is the Arabic language written in Hebrew characters. And that's where the tables of life and death came from. So the one I have up on the board is, or on the screen, is a recipe for a headache. You write these letters and numbers on a lead plate, the right column on the front side and the left column on the back side, and you hang it up. Pretty straightforward. The wheel here is a calendar that tells you when the moon rises and sets on different days of the month. And I should say that these are the Judeo-Arabic fragments, the loose leaf sheets that are in Arabic but Hebrew characters, which will prepare you for what's underneath the wheel, which is a recipe effective for a woman experiencing heavy non-menstrual bleeding. The incantation reads, لِكُلِّ نَبَأْ مُسْتَقَرْ وَقِيلَ يَا أَرْضَ أَبْلَعِ مَاءَكْ وَيَسَّمَاءُ أَقْلَعِ وَغِيضَ الْمَاءِ. And these are in Hebrew characters, so I couldn't find the source at first, but eventually discovered that they're Quran verses from the story of Noah's flood. And it's perfectly it makes sense why these are the verses that would be effective against bleeding. And what might be surprising to many is Jews using the Quran. In fact, this is quite common, and it goes in every direction. Muslims, too, would have used powerful verses and symbols derived from Jewish and Christian traditions. If it was known to be effective, then why would you let ideological scruples get in the way? For that matter, how many of us would turn down a life-saving drug if we had some ethical problems with the manufacturers? Here we see a spell that's good to use when something has been stolen. Presumably it will lead you to either the thief or the object. The main part of the spell on the top consists of God's names in Arabic, the giver of life and the creator. Some are connected Arabic letters, some are separated Arabic letters. The bottom consists of several magic squares, where each row and each column adds up to 15. There are only four ways of doing this for 3x3 squares, and each one is associated with a different one of the four elements. Here's one that's one of my absolute favorites. It's still very much an enigma. I don't know who this person was or why they were writing these things. Reading from right to left, the first page and the first half of the second page, they're an excerpt from a genre called prophetic medicine, meaning medical traditions attributed to the Prophet Muhammad. It's in Hebrew script composed by a Jew, and probably the logic is no different than the logic used in Quran verses. The writer does not believe that Muhammad was a prophet, but he still thinks he's worth hearing out on the pharmacological properties of different kinds of seeds. It's not just Muhammad who's credited here, but also Hippocrates, who is considered the founder of humoral medicine. He tells us here, for example, that garlic combined with honey is extremely effective for reducing phlegm. Suddenly, and on the middle of the second page, we see a larger font, and it shifts to a new subject entirely. What's written there is the classic invocation of three angels, Sanoi, Sansanoi, and Samangalaf, who protect newborns against the demon Lilith. And actually, in the current exhibit of Shiviti amulets in the room next door, you'll see the same angels on mostly amulets from Europe, I believe, although Francesco could say more. However, the angels and those manuscripts are certainly not associated with the Prophet Muhammad or Hippocrates, which they are here. The last set of things I'll show you from the Judeo-Arabic fragments are, I found three different alternate versions of the spell for prognosis, the tables of life and death. Each one has a slightly different algorithm, which is a little bit perturbing. The patient's survival is less a matter of their constitution and the disease, and more about which spell you happen to choose, right? It's at times like this that I can't really help my skepticism. What if they have seen, time and again, that the algorithm failed to accurately predict the outcome? And surely we've moved beyond this in modern medicine. To some extent, the answer is yes. There is a booming field of evidence-based medicine, which aims to break down clinical decisions into a matter of statistics. And it's brought enormous gains. But there's also a difference between the statistical data that exists and how an individual provider incorporates data into their practice. Here's a survey article I found from 2005, which notes the limiting factor is not the lack of scientifically sound guidelines, it's whether or not providers actually adopt them, understandably, because human brains are notoriously bad at processing statistics. So now we'll move on to the Hebrew-Italian book, and that whole book is up front. When I first came across it, I felt like I stepped into the restricted section of the Hogwarts library, more or less like this. This is the front cover of the book. It's bound in animal skin of obscure provenance and written in an almost unreadable chicken scratch replete with occult symbols. The scribes of the isolated fragments I've been talking about until now might have dabbled in magic, but whoever wrote this was a magician through and through. I've spent a lot of time trying to figure out where this book came from and how it ended up among the Karaites of Cairo. The front cover isn't especially useful for this. It may be telling us that somebody named Yosef Chaim, perhaps from the Karaite community, acquired the book around 1879, 5,639 years since the creation of the world. The back cover is mainly interesting for the fact that we see the binding, which is made out of a printed Arabic translation of the Psalms. In theory, we could figure out what translation or which printing this is, and then figure out when the binding was done. The most clues that I was able to find were on this page. It's the title page for the appendix in the book. The appendix is called The Book of the Generations of Man, credited to a Rabbi Yosef of Urbino in Italy, with a composition date of 1680. The scribe names himself, and I believe he's the author of the main spellbook. He's the poor and humble Shlomo Padua, and he doesn't tell us anything else about himself. Based on the rabbis that he cites elsewhere in the volume, he probably copied this book between the year 1777 and 1807, making it one of the oldest datable items among the Karaite manuscripts here at the Magnes. There's no hint of Arabic anywhere in the volume, but Shlomo Padua is familiar with a number of rabbis who were active in Jerusalem at this time, so it was likely composed either in Italy or in Palestine. On the next slide, I'll show you just a few of the types of texts to be found in this book. The first is a Kabbalistic prayer, specifically Lurianic Kabbalah, for those familiar with Jewish mysticism. At the end of the volume are a number of pages devoted to alchemical transformations, such as changing the color of metals, turning silver into gold, or, as on this page, increasing the weight of a batch of silver by one-third. These ones are especially interesting to me because, unlike many of the other recipes, there has to be an immediate, tangible result for the author to be spending his time on them. I'm curious, and don't have an answer, as to whether the writer thought he was literally turning silver into gold, or if he was aware that it was an illusion. And here's a page of divination based on something called geomancy. The dashes in the margins represent different patterns drawn on sand, labeled with the Italian name for each configuration. Next, I'll show you some of the symbols used that this magician could draw on, mainly because these are the most visually striking and coolest things to share from this manuscript. The ones up in the corner are, it just says, a great and wondrous secret, without telling you what the secret is. This one is a spell of healing. It's the Hebrew word refuah, which means healing, written out in different permutations of its letters. This one is for safety and grace, difficulty in childbirth, the pattern of Rabbi Eliezer HaKalir, which you bake into a cookie, the name of God, inscribed in a star, which is effective, it cancels the magic cast by somebody else. This one's an all-purpose seal based on a different name of God, Ehaya. And here we get into the territory of these mysterious alphabets, symbols made out of balls and sticks, which are very hard to decipher. This one happens to be effective for turning invisible. This one will stop bleeding. And I was very excited when I found this entry because it's a key to the code. This is the secret alphabet written out, Aleph, Bet, Gimel, Dalet, etc., with each letter corresponding to the secret code. So this is useful for deciphering things elsewhere in the volume. And just a couple more from this volume before I talk more generally about what my research has found. In the same genre that we've seen several times, there are spells in this Italian and Hebrew book that will tell you if a sick person is going to live or if they're going to die. For the one here, all you do is write certain symbols into your palm and then walk into the room of the sick person. If their mood is good or if they're laughing, then they will unfortunately die. If they are depressed or crying, then they will live. And the one on the right adopts a numerological approach that's very similar to the Judeo-Arabic ones that we saw at the beginning. You add up all the appropriate numbers, the patient's name and their mother's name, etc. This time you divide by 3 rather than 30, and depending on your remainder, you can determine if they will A, definitely live, B, definitely die, or C, if it's indeterminate, which is interesting for the unusual note of doubt that it injects into the equation. Here's the last one I'll show you from this book. It has a couple of interesting traits I want to point out. First of all, it's a poison. It's a poison recipe whose main ingredients are sulfuric acid and arsenic. There are a couple spots where the writer either can't think of the right Hebrew word or there's something that's easier said in Italian than in Hebrew. So I boxed those in red. I don't speak Italian, but several in the audience do. Maybe they can help me decipher it. There are also a couple spots, well, the most interesting part of this is the note penciled in on the left. It says in Hebrew, Asur la'asot, this is prohibited. One of the later owners of the book, not the person who wrote it originally, he went through and marked a dozen or so passages as prohibited. It makes sense why a deadly poison would be prohibited, but one thing I intend to do soon is figure out what pattern there is and what spells are prohibited and which ones aren't. Many of the love spells are prohibited, and definitely the one for summoning a female demon. The only other message left by this owner, he writes Asur la'asot in many places. But in one place he writes Sheker v'chezev, lies all lies, next to a set of horoscopes that predict success and failure in marriage. Do with that what you will. We have no biographical details about Shlomo Padua that I know of, but we have something that's even better. There's a complete catalog of, this book is a complete catalog of all the things that he spent his time thinking and worrying about. We can't be sure that he personally tried all these recipes. I have my doubts about the teleportation ones, but some of them he certainly did, and others he regarded as essential services that he should be able to provide for clients or family or friends or teach to students. Here I've artificially divided some of the most common spells into medical and non-medical ones. Importantly, the writer himself did not separate them this way. All of them are side by side, the spell for toothache right next to the spell for a heartache. If this was indeed written 200 years ago, like I think, whether in Italy or Palestine, the general population wouldn't have been especially medicalized. Today, it wouldn't occur to us to seek treatment for seizures anywhere other than a doctor. But for an epileptic in Jerusalem in 1800, a figure like the person who wrote this book might well be your destination for any form of distress, physical or emotional. The title Magician as Primary Care Doctor is somewhat tongue-in-cheek, but what I've said about this magician's clientele is not something unique to that historical context. Here are some quotes from an assessment of the state of U.S. mental health care, shedding some light on how primary care doctors occupy remarkably similar roles as this magician probably did. When a patient having a mental disorder presents to a primary care clinician, she or he usually does so with a physical complaint. 2/3 of patients with a psychiatric diagnosis also have a significant physical illness, and it's well established that chronic medical illnesses taken as a whole increase the likelihood of depression by 2 or 3-fold. These quotes drive in the point that it's the exception rather than the norm when patients come to a doctor with an isolated physical or psychological ailment that can be treated and cured, and the person will then returns to their baseline. It's a popular image in our culture. Think of a character like Dr. House who makes a brilliant diagnosis, after which it's simply a matter of administering the right drug, and the patient lives happily ever after. But by far the greater portion of illness is not acute concerns, but chronic ones, like diabetes or high blood pressure or heart failure. And nobody experiences a chronic illness without also experiencing psychological or spiritual aspects to that illness. Since we've already jumped from the year 1800 to the year 2017, we might as well rewind the clock 1,000 years and look at a poet from medieval Spain, Solomon Ibn Gabirol, whose poems constantly blur the boundary between psychological and physical suffering. We know that he, in fact, did suffer from a number of chronic illnesses, He writes about them vividly in his poetry. One poem names the pustules on his legs after biblical characters who meet violent ends. In the poem I've chosen here, he writes an angry letter to a friend who he feels has betrayed him. You can hardly tell where the suffering from the abandonment ends and the suffering from the physical ailments begins. You quarrel with a man whose tears are all that keep the fire in his heart from burning up his entrails. Control yourself, be quiet, is what you say, as if it weren't bad enough that separation has exhausted all his tears, that illness has emaciated him so badly that a fly could pick him up with just one arm. He murmurs as he weeps, as if his eyes contained the whole Euphrates, as if he had a belly full of lutes. His pains have overturned him, turned his earth to sky, his sky to earth. Since his friend betrayed him, he has sworn never again to seek repose and sleep. Now, if Solomon ibn Gabirol had someone like our magician to turn to, it's quite possible that he'd be in much better shape. There's a spell to bring back friends who have grown distant, and there are plenty of spells that would work to heal burning entrails and get some fat back on his bones. Or maybe not. A diehard skeptic will think that ibn Gabirol would be wasting his time. Far better would be to consult a dietitian and learn how to stop alienating his friends. It's an open question, how effective were these magical remedies that we've seen? What I'm really asking about is the placebo effect. When we hear the word placebo, we tend to dismiss it as a fake or somehow imaginary effect. If an experimental medication performs no better than placebo, then we conclude that the medication is worthless, instead of figuring out the basis for why the placebo is effective. It's a question that's extremely pressing today. If we completely understood the relationship between placebo effect and pain control, we certainly wouldn't have 2 million people in this country addicted to prescription opiates, which also don't actually work to adequately treat their pain. The question posed in the paper I've pasted here is, can the performance of a healing ritual have clinical significance? The answer turns out to be yes, absolutely, and it works best for things that are measured by a patient's subjective response as opposed to a laboratory test. This means placebo is more effective against the experience of chronic pain than against the progression of metastatic cancer. Ted Kapchuk, the author of this article, writes, a placebo's active ingredient is a person's psychological response to being treated. This has been confirmed by magnetic resonance imaging studies in which placebo is directly involved in emotion and valuation. The conclusion is that placebo causes a reevaluation of the pain. It doesn't mean the same thing to the person suffering. Poem from Ibn Gabirol, the same poet. My throat is all inflamed with crying, my tongue is sticking to my mouth. How long must I hold on to hope? How long must my anger burn? Maybe speaking of my troubles would bring me some relief from horror. It could be that if he went to the magician, he would get spells for every one of his ailments. And it's possible that they would be entirely effective, not through any occult power, but simply because he would have been able to speak of his troubles, and that alone would bring him relief from his horror. When I first started studying these manuscripts, I was most enamored with the exotic items in the spells, the frog's eyes and copper cauldrons, and the elaborate numerology. But the more time I spent with them, the more familiar the patients and the healers seemed to me. The issues they dealt with are fundamentally no different in the 11th century, the 19th, or the 21st. One lesson I'm taking from these manuscripts is that magic comes in not at the level of the objects, but at the level of human contact. A healer encountering somebody in suffering, whether physical, emotional, or social suffering. And especially that good healing takes these links between mind and body into account, whether we call it placebo or empathy or magic. That's it. There's one very cool epic poem in Hebrew about the Ottoman sultans. There's a woman, Lisa Wortley, who went through and cataloged all the Karaite manuscripts here. So I've been definitely relying on her work. Those are the ones that come to mind, but there's many more. And I haven't even gotten into the artifacts or objects that that we also have.
Are you going to practice some magic when you engage in your medical school?
Definitely. My medical school classmates are laughing. But they will too. Archana? Francesco has a great answer for that.
So I actually wanted to bring up that manuscript for a couple of reasons. First is that I think that's a North African or Middle Eastern copy of an Italian manuscript. Mm-hmm. Although likely the copyist knew some Italian because of the Italian script and the Italian words in there. But the Hebrew script is not an Italian Hebrew script. The author, this rabbi from Urbino, was a medical doctor himself. We know very little about him, but he was a medical doctor, a rabbi, and that's a very common connection in Renaissance and all the way to the 21st century in Italy among Jews to have medical doctors who are also rabbis. The current chief rabbi of Rome is a professor in a school of medicine in Rome. And it's just a long chain of tradition there. He was from this small town of Busseto, which is known to the chronicles of music because Giuseppe Verdi was born there. But there was a tiny Jewish community there into the 20th century. And he was a student of Leone Modena, who's one of the most famous Renaissance rabbis. So there are a lot of very interesting connections there. The question about whether the copyist is Shlomo Padua or Shlomo of Padua, in other words, we still need to work out who the copyist was. And then, of course, try to figure out who copied that original manuscript in the copy that we have here at the Magnes. So there are many, many layers to this, but the interesting fact is that the various connections with the medical profession that emerge from this manuscript, which brings me to one other question that I have for you. And I know we talked about this a bit, but in dealing with amulets and other magical texts, but especially protective, there is a little bit of there is a difference, right, between protective texts and healing ones, right? And there is an overwhelming majority of protective documents in the Jewish traditions around the world. And those are very much in line with sort of the modern concerns about health insurance, homeowner insurance. There are protective spells to protect one's body and physical well-being, a child's body and well-being, a pregnant woman during pregnancy, and also to protect homes from fires and other kinds of calamities. So the notion of insurance, which, you know, to a European like me, still doesn't gel with the notion of you know, medical and insurance. We shouldn't go together, right? It should be medical care and not insurance, but seems to actually resonate a lot in these texts. So I was wondering how you process that aspect of the protective part rather than the healing.
Yeah, my mind is going a few different places. The first is, of course, that many Jews are very familiar with protective amulets because the mezuzah that we have on the every doorpost, more or less, also fulfills that function in many traditions, protecting the house against the harm from outside. I would say that most of what I've been looking at, pretty much it's a spell that's prefaced by what the spell is good for. So these are much more in terms of active magic, calling upon names of God or calling upon certain things to conduct a certain action to influence the world. There are a number of them, especially in the book, the Hebrew and Italian book, that they don't have a purpose per se. They just say, this is a powerful name, or this is the name of God that does, this is the 72-letter name of God. So I would think that many of the seals and many of those names are better thought of as protective, or there are some that are just good for everything, like success in all your ways, and it lists out every possible way that you could succeed. Which seems like, why wouldn't you go for that spell? If, like, what's with all the rest? But so that I guess that speaks to different people's level of faith and different spells, right? That if that was sufficient, if you believed 100% that that was going to be effective to protect you, then you wouldn't need the specific protection when you go on a journey. I don't know if that answers the question, but it's a thought-provoking line of inquiry. Peyton? It's a question I hadn't thought about at all.
Can you repeat the question for anyone?
Oh, yeah.
Because it was hard to hear.
To what extent these spells, separating out the relationship between the person, like almost the patient person and the healer person, and whether it makes a difference if the healer is the one who performs a spell or if the one who's suffering or needs something performs the spell for themselves. Is that right? It's interesting that almost every manuscript I've seen is not, like they're still kind of like the arcane medical textbooks that we have today, like these are still like specialized knowledge that are only supposed to be circulated within the group in the know. Sometimes they directly address the student, like, oh, know, oh student, that this is a fantastic spell that I found in this book by the, you know, Abu Ma'ashad. So most of these are written with it in mind that the magician or the practitioner is going to be the one carrying them out. But it also says, like, if you want someone to fall in love with you, then do this. So presumably if the healer did that, then like it would backfire and you'd end up with a triangle and you'd need the other spell to undo them. I think one part where I did get a sense of how these might have been circulated and who might have been doing what is, there's one for invisible ink that was another one that probably worked. I haven't thought to like try the exposing invisible ink method on different parts of the manuscript. I don't think Francesca would allow that. Pouring lemon juice all over the Magnes.
Julie would allow that.
Exactly.
If Francesca would, Julie would say absolutely not. But the invisible ink recipe, it says in parentheses, like, this is, or it says, if there are times when you want to pass a message, like, unknown, parentheses, in school or in war, which is fantastic. And then at the end it says, like, this is very, like, very special, don't reveal it to anyone except very close friends, or very, like, initiates. So certainly, I think there was an idea that lay people weren't supposed to be having this knowledge, and that they would have to resort to someone who did know. In the back.
Do you think that since, as you said, Karaites lived among other Jews at the same time, that there's something unique about the Karaite experience and history in terms of what's contained here, or could other Jewish sources of the time come up with the same thing? Or would this kind of thing be more of an emphasis because you don't have the background of rabbinic Judaism and Rabbi so-and-so interpreted such and such? Mm-hmm. Or could this have come from other Jewish sources other than Karaites?
That's a really, really good question and difficult to answer sometimes. So the Hebrew-Italian book, I don't think is Karaite in origin in any way. I think it was acquired by the Karaite community. Part of it, that they, like, there's the cake recipe, that is the cake of Rabbi Eliezer HaKalir. So there are signs like that. And on the other hand, some of the Judeo-Arabic manuscripts, like, specifically wish for peace upon all B'nai Mikra, or the sons of scripture, aka the Karaites. Another response to that might be that I met with one of the experts on the history of the Karaites last summer in Israel, a man named Guy Ben Shammai, who told me that historically Karaites have been far more eclectic gatherers of books and knowledge than rabbinic Jews would have been. They were always a minority, depending on where we're looking in the world, but in Cairo, for example, they were a minority. relative to the mainstream rabbinic Jews. So of necessity, they knew all about rabbinic Judaism, they read their books, they knew all about Islam and the people around them. And even Karaites in other places in the world, like Crimea. So it's no surprise at all that we have this Hebrew-Italian book created by a rabbinic Jew in the hands of the Karaite community. And there was some, there's a great slide that I took out of a manuscript from the Cairo Genizah from 1,000 years ago, where it's a Karaite version of the Bible, where it's Hebrew written in Arabic letters, the opposite of the Judeo-Arabic that I've been talking about. But that's something that wouldn't have occurred to rabbinic Jews to do. I hope I'm doing justice to the Karaites. I'm conscious of Karaites in the audience and talking about Karaites. And how that, so if any other people in the audience have thoughts on that, then I'd be delighted to hear. Maybe afterward. Amanda.
Hi. Thanks so much. That was a really informative and really exact talk. I thought towards the end of your talk, you were moving towards maybe an implicit or explicit argument about the continuity of the human body and like human ailments throughout time. Like we all want to be able to fall in love and be successful and get rid of our hemorrhoids. So there's this, it's this linear, continuous, argument that humans have always, in some sense been the same, and the human body has been, constant in some way. But I want to trouble that a bit because of, some things that we know about, for example, from the contemporary pharmaceutical industry, and the ways that the pharmaceutical industry, the drug industry, creates diseases, creates diagnoses that then proliferate. And there was a recent Harvard psychologist prominent one who came out and said, there's overdiagnosis of age, and this said people have been making this argument. Well, I'm just wondering, so we know that there are ways in which this medical medical problems, things they're up in moments, they're up at different times. So I'm wondering, could you extrapolate backwards 200 years ago and talk about the ways in which there were systems or things, the structures that were proliferating, the things that you see in this text, that are not necessarily continuous with our contemporary moment.
That's a fantastic question, and we should talk at much greater length about that. I want to be conscious of people's time. It's 12:59, so if you do have to run at 1, by all means. Absolutely. I think I completely agree with the preface to the question in every way. There's certainly no diagnoses of ADHD or spells against, even like very few that we would categorize as mental illness. There's one for like sickness of heart, or someone whose heart is sick. I don't really know what that means. And of course, I'm assuming going into this that the pathological processes and the biochemistry of how bodies work is constant over time. But the interpretation, of course, that we put on that, like the different groupings of diagnoses that we have, are drastically different in 1800 versus today, or even in one part of the world versus this part of the world. And there are examples, there are new diagnoses today, and there are also diagnoses that have fallen out of favor. At this time, in medieval manuscripts, we find a lot of, love sickness was a medical illness, lycanthropy, where you are possessed with an urge at the full moon to go howling in graveyards. I don't think we have that anymore. I haven't consulted with DSM. I'm not sure that I'm doing justice to the question. I think that would merit a whole other talk. But certainly, I might have overplayed the continuity aspect and make it a lot more interesting if we talked about discontinuities. Mary Ellen?
From the research you've done thus far, would you draw any correlations between magic and prayer? Or what kind of correlations would you draw?
The boundary is very blurry. There are some of these spells, I'm calling them spells for lack of a better word and not in any derogatory way. There are some that consist of reciting a psalm, 28 times, which is often very similar to a prayer. prayer. There are also some, there are spells for achieving that which you pray for. So as if the prayer isn't enough, then you like supplement it with an extra thing. But I mean, very similar in the sense that, not in two senses. One, in that if you're praying for something, then you're trying to persuade God to, you know, make a change in the world to make you happier. So that's certainly what these spells are. Maybe not asking, but like summoning God, or these powerful divine names to do your what you want. But I think another way in which prayer and these are very similar is like the subjective experience of how it works. Like I had a rabbi in middle school who always said that you don't pray for God. God doesn't need your prayers. You pray for yourself, and that like if you pray for, you know, if you want God to help you be kinder to others, then like that action of praying is itself the thing you're praying for. So I think in some ways these spells are can be similar. If you're meditating on love, then maybe you're more likely to find it. Maybe less likely if you hide an egg underneath the bed of the beloved.
There is a whole exhibition next door that explores the relationship between magic, meditation, and prayer.
Absolutely. And I invite you, too, to come look at these manuscripts in the flesh or in the paper.
Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation.